them anymore in the store. They used to have a thing called where you push the button, it starts going. It's called a speed watch, or what do you call that? A stopwatch.
The stopwatch, yeah.
They don't have them anymore because everything's, no, they're all on these damn phones. They're all on the smartphones, so everybody's got that.
There's a stopwatch.
Yeah, they don't have it. I went in a store, they don't have a stopwatch anymore. They don't have DVDs anymore. They don't have VHSs. Stop the world. It's going too fast. The transformation.
Okay.
Welcome. Welcome very, very much to Conversations. Pleasure to welcome to the program. Filling in, as it were, we were going to do another program with our friend Maggie.
Yes.
She's had a little bit of a problem there, and we really appreciate we've done other programs with a major artist friend of mine, and that's Pamela Timmins. She's a very beautiful painter, both figurative and abstract and everything, and she has a great artistic sense, and she's photography as well. And she's done video, and she has a great appreciation for Amerindian traditions, and also a great feeling for the natural order of the natural world.
Yes.
All of which is very becoming of the fact that she's a major artist, and it's good to welcome her to the program, and so forth, and so good to see you again. Thanks for coming in and everything.
To be here.
No, that's all really true. I know you very well, and I know your work, and it's really all good.
And you too, all the work that you have.
Well, I'm a different kind of hairy ape kind of thing. I'm a male, and you're a female, and the females seem to, we're going to be talking about male, female, or we're going to be talking in a sense about, let the mic come out.
Okay.
We're going to be talking about liberation of the female contingent of the human society, both historically and philosophically and in contemporary terms. And I told you, one of my most impressive people ever intellectually in my life was Bucky Fuller. I think most all of the artistic and thoughtful community associated with him. And on the day when they did not vote the Equal Rights Amendment, ERA, he wept bitter tears when they did not pass the Equal Rights Amendment. You know,
so heartfelt.
Yeah.
He's really in touch with his feelings.
Very in touch with the feeling and the larger encompassing issues rather than some specialized something that you focus on, like a bottom line, say, in a contract or something like that and everything. But anyway,
I really do think it's a time where men are going to be getting in touch with their feelings and able to cry.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's important. It's a release.
Crying,
Well,
we used to say you're a crybaby. You see, if you're a man, you're not supposed to cry.
I remember that.
Don't cry.
Yeah.
You know, and all that. But I think maybe they should, or something. There's a whole lot of unification going on between the various parts of the operation of the natural order and of the human order and so forth. Time of qualitative transformation and blending. And one of the things is that the respect for the feminine principle has to be made much more manifest and respected by one and all. And that's sort of what
happening.
We want to talk about today,
That's what's happening. In fact, just last month, we had a women's march that started Washington, D.C., and New York City, millions of women
Literally millions?
Yeah.
Oh, was that after the election?
Yes.
Oh, that was a fantastic outpouring. Absolutely. Yeah, talk about that. Yeah.
Well, right here in New York City, 400,000 plus
That's
women
amazing.
Came together in a totally peaceful gathering. And so there's a slideshow that I want to present.
That's right. We're going to show that almost just in a couple seconds or so. We're just really setting it up.
It resonated with Washington, D.C., that also had hundreds of thousands. In this country, in the United States, they say over 3 million women were out on that day.
Wow.
And around the globe, about 6 million women were out letting it be known that they want equality.
a million here, a million there, finally adds up to real numbers, yeah, that sort of thing. Yeah.
Well, this is movement Rise.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And they're looking for 1 billion women to come out.
So. And another event that's on the is scheduled mm-hmm. for the future in that?
Yes.
When
yes.
is that? Can we just mention?
Rise actually just had an event at Washington Square Park on Valentine's Day.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, it was so beautiful.
That's Maggie's birthday.
Oh.
Yeah, as it happened.
Happy birthday, Maggie.
Yeah, Maggie. Happy birthday, Maggie. Yeah. But anyway, yeah.
And then there's a film that they've brought forth called City of Joy.
That's another one?
Yeah.
Now, we're going to show a film. In fact, we're just setting it up now. I guess they're setting it up in the booth. Just really quickly introduce it, why don't you?
All right.
We show it at the outset.
Well, this is a slideshow produced by Janet Restino, an artist that I've collaborated with over the years.
Uh-huh.
And she was right there in the center of the Women's March. So we feel like we are there, present in the solidarity.
Okay.
And then a musician that she's been working with has put a soundtrack. So let's hear.
So let's see if we can set that up. It might take a second or two to get it rolling and everything. And it's we're talking with Pamela Timmins, and let's see if they roll that film. I remember. There we go. Women's March, 21st of November. Oh my gosh. Okay. And you say 4 million. Well, let's let the soundtrack roll and the film. Thank you. Or do we talk over it?
There's a musical soundtrack.
Oh. Is there a soundtrack?
Yeah, maybe we're just not hearing it. Volume up on the soundtrack.
Can we put the volume up on the soundtrack, perhaps? Oh, look at this. Oh, this is a slideshow of the thing here in New
Where's
York.
Where's Lily wanna be? It's plain for all to see. Mussolini wannabe.
Maybe it's
You might say, who was he?
I hear it subtly.
Hitler's buddy back in 43.
Yeah.
Mussolini wannabe.
This is art workers don't kiss. There's a lot of creativity comes up.
We all know the press has the power.
Also, a lot of vehemence is being manifested, right?
That doesn't mean you can go and act like
this. The day after the inauguration. And it was all over the world, but did you see
what we really need, though?
Where did they go?
It's a leader for all women and men, not a guy with such a thin skin.
United Nations, Mussolini Plaza.
Uh-huh.
And then they walked down First Avenue along 42nd Street.
Oh, that's a traditional march.
We're talking about presidency.
And who put that all together? It must have been a coalition.
He said his businesses can't conflict.
That's the same number of people.
That sure sounds like Tricky Dick. Been down this road before. Thought we'd shut that door. But here we are in an even worse boat. He didn't even win the popular vote. I really can't stand that hair, and he just thinks he can grab anywhere.
Yeah, right.
But we can be
victorious.
We're the ones he'll be screwing.
There we are at,
just because he doesn't know what he's doing. I couldn't look the other way when he said what he said about the Mexicans. Couldn't look the other way when he said what he said about the Mexicans. Couldn't look the other way when he said what he said about Muslims. His parking song could go on for so long, make me want to shout. But if you know it's what the scientists tell us, we may not have a planet to argue about. Mussolini wannabe.
It was amazing. I remember it was I came upon it by accident. I said, my lord. And it was huge, the people. I mean, And it was the largest contingent here.
Did you hear about what his ex-wife had said, though?
Yeah.
Used to keep Hitler's speeches right next to his bed, you know. I know we're all so tired of the Hitler analogy.
Don't cover your mic.
This is kind of played out. So this is what it's gotta be.
Yeah, right, right.
Mussolini wanna be. If you check out some history, Italy in 43.
6 million people were in support on this very day, on January 21st. Well, there must have been some planning going into that.
Yeah.
I think Michael Moore was into that.
Look the other way if he wants to avoid racists. Can't look the other way if he buddies up to
Putin. Hey, Jeff, that's another thing.
Can't look the other way if he's not serving all of us.
Is there a movement of feminist movement?
Can't look the other way if he shows us his
hand. Okay,
does these things he said he's gonna do, we gotta throw him out on his can.
Wait a minute, there's only about, what is that, about Mrs. 7 billion. In 1 billion, that would be,
because he's busy.
Well, they could be 3.5 billion, that'd be only half, that'd be half the population of the world. And I mean, what prevents the people who've been, the female contingent of the human society have been
right
oppressed by long historical pattern?
Yeah.
Wouldn't you fair to say that that's one of the major groups?
Oh, yeah.
And that's half the population of the world,
yeah,
right?
Definitely.
And they've not been given their due as a force for social concern and so forth.
Yeah.
And they have some things to say and some issues that they want to become part of the human dialogue.
That's right.
What are some of the major issues on the people's mind that are behind this and behind the feminist movement in the world?
Yeah.
Which is, again, after all, that's half the population of the world, isn't it, you know?
Yeah, well, I mean, this is a tremendous outcry of the women, and there were men involved with this as well, and we want more men to feel liberated and feel to come along and be respectful of what we're asking for.
Bucky Fuller wept when they didn't pass the equal rights. That was really, that would be better for Dan
Bucky
and those pioneers and all that.
Yeah.
That was going on.
And he was such an innovator and understood that, you know, we have to respect and honor our women and not to oppress them. And there's been such violence against women.
Yeah.
There's a tremendous movement. Rising is one of the...
Do you think the male principle, or let's just say, I have a tendency to talk like Bucky Fuller, the male principle of female, east, west, or however you divide it up and everything, that the most violent part of the human expression, is the male function is the more violent one? The more one prone to violent, more war-minded, more outer-directed, not so much trying to preserve the gentler visions of a harmonious society, but are out to make a point, politically active, that sort of thing.
Yeah. Well,
does it take a form that has meaning?
Yeah.
The division between the sexes. I guess it's always been there for a few million years.
Well,
in the human case,
there is, I mean, we come together and we create life.
Yeah,
we wouldn't be here without both man and woman.
That's right.
But through the social conditioning of the man being a more aggressive energy and going out and, you know.
You think that's universally the case in the male I mean, there's a male and female principle operative in universe apart from human beings. We're part of that. There's mosquitoes. There's other kinds of amoebas and things like that. There is. It's a broader division of life form. I mean, other than human, we focus on that. But it comes out in bears. It comes out in dogs. It comes out in kittens and things like that, doesn't it?
Yeah, the mammals. But when women are pregnant, they have to be nurturing themselves.
Yeah,
and they
absolutely
can't be out, you know, destroying things. Mm. So, you know, it's about the nurturing process and the respect.
How important the nurturing process is.
Yeah.
I mean, not only for the newborn and everything, just imagine how vulnerable absolutely, totally vulnerable a newborn infant is. And I suppose that applies for puppies or kittens or other forms and everything like that.
So both
and
men
nurturing
and
is so
women
important.
Nurture and protect.
That's right. Yeah,
know, and that's why we're here.
Yeah.
You know, but then at a certain point, we have to really bring the attention to the boys and the young men to respect the girls and their mothers, because somehow the social conditioning has allowed this oppressive.
Does it seem that way? We read history. Does it seem that way? It seems mostly there were kings and sultans, and not so many women in positions of authority for political institutions or business, and so forth.
Well, that's
their
happened.
Place was in the home. That kind of thinking and everything.
Yeah, and which is fine, but to have the respect for home.
Yeah.
You know, there's been tremendous.
Yeah, absolutely. That's where a whole lot of nurture. No, that's where a whole lot of conditioning goes on. Important conditioning for the adult to be emerging out of the home setting. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very important. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, to create the home life, and that can be both man and woman.
And it has a way of having psychological communication between various members of an of a community, whether it's human or some band of creatures or something like that. That's important too, the nurturing and the nurturing of what is.
Yeah.
Rather than necessarily seeking out what might become or something, which they got an arrow off what is supposed to be the male.
Yeah.
Movement, that kind of thing.
Right.
Sometimes it's compared east is east and west is west, and the east is compared with the feminine principle and male with the with the western principle, or that kind of thing.
Yeah, well, I think that right now it's a kind of transformative time where...
I agree with that, it sure is,
We're realizing we have to sustain our lives and the life of Mother Earth.
Yeah,
If the men will really take some time
let
to
up
listen.
A little bit, maybe from the Stella
it's coming out of fear and survival.
I think we're very frightened
of what is happening, you know, with all of civilization right now.
I think you're too young to remember the really big march. I think the biggest ever march in New York was in 1982. Were you here then?
1982.
That was against the atomic bomb.
Uh-huh.
1 million people filled all the streets of New York and all of Central Park. It was magnificent.
Uh-huh.
And that was against atomic destruction of the weapon systems, mostly created by men and the men's ego and that kind of thing and their wars. They mostly do the fighting of the wars and whatnot.
That's right.
And all that kind
of
stuff.
So that's what this movement is about, is, you know, stop with the atomic bomb threat. And, you know, we grew up with the idea that we had to hide from the atomic bomb.
You didn't have that. You're too young to remember that. You didn't have to do duck and cover. Did you have to do?
Yeah.
I thought you looked far too young to be able to have been involved in that.
Well, they're still doing things like this.
Are they really? Duck and cover? I don't know if the young children out there know about it. They're going to drop the atomic bomb. All right, kiddies, all get under your desk and cover your heads and duck and cover against the atomic bomb, just to put the to put the fear.
Yeah, that's it, the fear. And through that fear, they manipulate us.
There's too much fear in the world, maybe, do you think?
Yes.
And do you think fear is a good thing for selling Coca-Cola or any other product? I mean, that's part of an advertising campaign that could be done.
Yeah, well, Coca-Cola has done great with advertising. But yeah, there's a tremendous amount of fear and division, and we look to overcome that by... you know, being there in solidarity.
So how does it go with the ladies in terms of, let's say, animals and stuff, like gorillas? Like you've got male gorillas and female, and the males go boom, boom, boom. And I big male, I tough, I got atomic bomb, I got Gatling gun, I got, you know, that kind of stuff.
Yeah,
and that's been largely, the men go off to fight.
Right.
You know, and they, you know.
Well, again, and social conditioning, all these wars, the retaliation. And this is a time for reconciliation.
I think so, don't you?
Yeah.
Well, why should we have serious reconciliation or just a PR thing? Or what are we talking? Are we talking just a little blip and then they'll all go back to hitting each other over the head and everything like that? They seem to have a penchant for just attacking and ginning up fear against the enemy as a way of getting some control over. It has to do with control of some. Mm-hmm. They have people whose personalities, yes. I'm rambling around here a little bit. Mm-hmm. They have personalities that are called control freaks.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? They want to control everything.
Uh-huh.
Now, there's some men and women both have that, do you think? Maybe we could just look at that.
Well,
that's a commonality.
But I do sense it's coming from an insecurity.
Yeah.
And fear-based, again, that one has to always be in control. And the women's movement is more of a free-flowing way of collaboration and bringing the cooperation back into the home and the workplace, schools, everywhere.
There's a lot to be said for cooperation, isn't there?
Yeah. We've become so competitive.
Yeah. That's right. Competitive in a general sense, not just the war, but competitive is a way that the universe is set up or something.
Yeah, well.
Competitors.
I would say the social conditioning has turned into.
Social conditioning in the case of human beings,
The testing in the schools have created this very competitive attitude, the sports. And it doesn't have to be like that. It would be actually good to go back and take a look at curriculum again.
Well, I was just thinking in sports, you wouldn't have much of a sport, the sport of, let's say, boxing.
Yeah.
Wouldn't have much there if it wasn't venting of competition and and you hear some of the nasty words are exchanged in the ring and so forth, because I'm going to kill you, I'm going to, and the people are doing that, and then intimidation in a pool hall and all the kind of places
where it's
like animals beating their chest. I don't think women do that as much.
Yeah, no.
Let's reason together more.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yeah.
I think women seem to be that way. They put things together and let's talk it out and let's figure something out that's a little bit more than just beating our chest and say me big chief or you I beat you up or something,
Yeah.
And that would be good among the nations, right?
Yeah,
that was in a certain sense that demonstration of the women was Women for Peace.
Yeah.
Aren't there a lot of organizations that are World Women for Peace and so forth that have a good deal of tenure in the society, because it seems to be they're more the feminine principle seems to be more organized toward let's talk this out.
That's right.
Do you think we could use more of that and less competition?
Yes.
Is there a place for competition? There is a place, I guess, for competition. Can there be friendly competition as opposed to, let's just say, evil competition? Destructive competition.
Yeah, exactly. It's really, the competitive nature has gone too far.
You think?
Yeah, it's become destructive. Mm. And we have to really pause and put the brakes on and take a look at where are we going with this. And the whole idea of dialogue.
Dialogue, okay.
And being receptive to each other rather than competing with each other, always thinking that I've got to be better than the other. We need to be able to work together.
I think it's better if people just get along, don't you?
Yeah,
exactly. It seems to me to be a good thing to generally encourage, among the people. But it seems to be this other thing. Well, I really am happy to hear they got that many people out in the streets of New York and so forth.
Yeah.
Was that a something?
Was
that a demonstration around the world of the fear? Because it was then clear that we were going to get a new president that a lot of people were associating with Mussolini or fascism Mr. Donald Trump. Yeah. There were a lot of people who felt that. A lot of people thought we're ready for something like that, like a lot of people in Italy. He did get the trains running on time.
Right.
And the fascism and the mail thing. One mail that one comes to mind is really drawn out is Adolf Hitler. He got a little bit over the top, to put it mildly, you know, with that kind of ego. That's ego? I don't know, psychological terms is ego other parts of consciousness and so forth. But it was a fear of over-aggressive kind of male running amok kind of thing that they see projected. They wanted to fight against, right?
Well, I think it's a movement of solidarity.
Against, is it?
Yeah.
No?
Well, yeah.
I mean, it was motivated by the fact if Hillary had won, there wouldn't be. If Hillary had won, that they probably wouldn't have done it. There wouldn't have been a demonstration. The people.
No.
The people that did maybe as an example. I don't know. I'm just fishing around here for the very big principle, men and women. Mm-hmm. I guess they've been talking about this since caves. I bet they talk. I'll bet you they talked about that woman is wearing that. That fur, literally, and not—it's not well tailored, you know. Or something, but no, I'm just making a joke and everything like that.
Right.
But that it's something that is being coming out. But they're fearful of that. And is there something that maybe this some progress comes from activity? It's not all just passive.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? A lot of good things come from the taking a chance or pushing the envelope or doing being active. Like the Wright brothers, don't be silly. You can't go up in that airplane and all of a sudden you got an industry flying airplanes all over the world, which is a bent. Do you understand?
Yeah.
And so there's something that comes out of that aggressive attitude also, which we would call progress. You know, it's not just all sweetness and light and, you know, or whatever.
Yeah.
How do we put these two things together in a reasonable area, taking into account how it can be put together, why it can be put together? Is there something different about our times than of history, or something that makes this possible now, a kind of utopian aspect to the vision that people have, whether it's from the right or the left? You know, there's a lot of discontent abroad in the world on both sides of the political, and I don't know if it's the same on the sexual differentiation or the differentiation of human society. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of upset and fear abroad in the world now, don't you think? In unusual numbers?
I think more than we've ever seen.
That's a lot, yeah.
Yeah, and yeah. I think that's what's so exciting about what just happened and continues to happen, that the ability to work with the social media, the people are coming together and they're resisting what could be tyranny. And because we're more educated than ever.
Wait a minute, that's an important thing. Yeah, okay, yeah.
We can really resist this. And there's more of us that want to resist and create it's really a transformative time of listening to each other, validating each other's stories, and moving in solidarity to create.
How do we avoid validating? I could just think of a sort of element, just thinking politically or something. It's easy to think politically. But you had a Berlusconi, you know, in Italy. He was a big, you know. How do you, or Huey Long, or things along the line of, or then Mussolini. He got the trains running on time. He ended up being hung or something. Do you understand?
Right.
How do you get that the benefits of, or just say technological progress. What do you mean you're going to fly in an airplane? Don't be silly. With this horse-drawn carriage is just perfectly fine for me, and it keeps the dirt churned up because, you know, what is some man? You know, all the naysayers to progress, let's just say, of change, technologically or otherwise, the naysayers of that could be dragging it back rather than allowing it to flow forward. There's a link between the two somehow, isn't there?
Right. Well, I think we're in a time of real innovation.
Uh-huh.
And through the innovation, we need to find a way to sustain our lives with Mother Earth, who provides all of this for us.
Okay, now that's a good thing to draw upon and not lose sight of. Because the other could be a runaway ego.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Pumped up ego.
Yeah. That's fear-based.
There's a lot of that going
There's
on in the world. I can see a lot of that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a propaganda. It's a manipulation of the people.
Consciousness.
Yeah, of consciousness. But through consciousness, we can actually rise above the social conditioning, the propaganda, and come together. And this is what we're witnessing. I mean, well,
both sides could say that against the other side. Mm-hmm. With the people who are in favor of, let's do it. Let's, you know, Franklin Roosevelt said, let's do something so crazy as make Social Security. Now, mm-hmm. what do you mean Social Security? There is no security. Life is a bitter fight.
Yeah.
You have to fight hard. You have to do, you know, all the argumentations.
That was transformative.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So how do we get progress? How do we get collectively able to husband the progress that is made, guarding against the destructiveness of what the progressive new way of what has been discovered, let's just say this thing called an airplane, which an automobile. You know, what do you mean you're going to get in an automobile? There's no horse to pull it. You know, all the thinking, the retrograde thinking. Mm. There's a tension between those two things, right?
Yeah. Well, I think it's really finding the balance.
Okay.
You know, when we had horses that would pull carriages or wagons.
That's all we had.
There was a relationship there of a give and take.
Between you and the horse?
Yeah, you had to take care of the horse and nurture the
horse.
Well,
you're an equestrian. You're an equestrian, So you have a feel for that.
Yeah. I know.
I always used to worry. Do you think the horses like being a horse?
Yeah, there's
You think they do like being ridden?
Relationship. Mm-hmm.
It seems like you have to break them. Did you ever see what they have to do to break an elephant out of the wild? It's horrible. They have to break the spirit in order to make it a plowing beast of burden.
Yeah, well,
they have to break the spirit that is born into. Do you understand?
I haven't seen it yet.
You have to break the spirit of people in order to make them good wage slaves, and they'll fit into an oppressive order and one where they don't get any sense of identity much out of it, and is the source of so much upset by individuals in terms of, there's a great deal of discontent in the world now, is there not? I mean, inordinate sense, for a time of material abundance and so forth, and opportunity, but at the same time, like you said, inordinate amount of concern or worry about the state of the world.
Yes, well, there's tremendous poverty.
And it's allowed to go on.
Yeah, and so this is why there is this movement around the globe.
Okay.
To really come into a transformative time and work with the technology, but also in respect to the natural resources.
Okay. That's an interesting thing. Do you think that limited resources? That's you think the resources are and will always necessarily be limited, or let's say another word for that is scarce, that there is not enough? If you had a world where there was enough love, if there was enough bread, if there was enough hot fudge sundaes or whatever makes for a warm shower you can get into rather than dive into a cold river, not because it's a lovely nature, but because that's the only way you can get clean in a state of nature or something. Yeah, all the thing, the tension between the progress toward material benefit for everybody. Wouldn't it be wonderful if everybody could have a living space? There are people sleeping in the streets of New York City that don't have a place to live.
It's so sad.
When you have you have such a capability to provide it, but for some reason the norms or the situation that they allow to have a larger import in terms of the structuring of the society, insist you have to have the least among us in order to have somebody that you can look down upon or that you can use or utilize as a quasi-slave. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of that comes in the name of male ego, I think, in the case of the family often. Right. Women are treated that way often. There have been out of history, all of that.
Yeah.
So how do we deal with the tension between the progress from activity and the maintaining of a tie with the more subtle resource base, for want of another term, not only just in terms of material resources, but emotional resources and so forth, like
that's
that love
right.
and these kind
yes.
of things that are really yes. important, you know? How are we going to work with that? And is it changing in a way that's making possible something that never has been possible?
Yes.
You think
I really
so?
Sense that.
A qualitative transformation may be in the offing.
Definitely.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's about listening to each other and, you know, having equal time for the listening and the sharing of ideas
mm-hmm.
and having, you know, true respect for what is being present rather than being stuck in the past.
Being stuck in the past. Now, wait a minute, if you don't mind. Being stuck in the past means being conservative, in a sense, and being
in the past,
not being all caught up with the latest gadget, but being concerned with the infant or the condition that exists and the security of what exists. We don't have to have another bear rug.
That's right.
You don't have to go out and kill another grizzly bear and risk your life. We've got enough for the baby to have a... Do you understand? There's a sufficiency. Those are two tensions.
Right.
Or don't take a chance. Don't take a chance on something new or something. We got enough, or we don't. Or the changing ratio in terms of our technological augmentation with the natural resources and our learning and our capability and all that kind of stuff and the movement of time is a thing we have to get some sort of a handle on if we're going through a qualitative, maybe a period of having a liberated order that is only to be seen in future tense. It can't be seen in the past because there's never been a technological or augmented capability that was able to provide for everybody. We've always had to have slaves. All throughout civilization, there's always the slaves in order to, do you understand? Are we at a time where maybe everybody can be liberated in a way?
This is a time where we really need to find a way of understanding that people have equal rights. And that's what is really moving forward.
You think so,
Yes, and we have the ability to change the social conditioning out of a fear-based, manipulative, idea that there is enough if we are intelligent about how we provide for each other. And right now the...
In a new way that there hasn't been historically?
I think that at times in other cultures we've had, but right now, no. I mean, when you take a look at the world at large, there's such an unfair distribution of wealth and, resources.
But there is more to be, there is more. I mean... In 1900, you could not fly from New York to California in 3 hours like you can now routinely, like going to the corner store back then.
Well,
there is progress being made.
A certain group of people, but there's millions of people that.
Well, let me use another one then. Let me use another one. You couldn't. In those days, you had a rutted road that got stuck in the mud, and you couldn't pull it, and they'd fall in, and the horse was all tired out at the end of the thing, to where you get it in an automobile on a paved highway that takes you at 90 miles an hour from one place to another, available to everybody. And it seems to be now the case in the civilized world.
Well,
everybody almost has access to an automobile.
Everybody
in the United States has access to an automobile. You have to have an automobile to live in the United States. Is that progress or not?
Well, I think
that it's mobility.
Public transportation is progress, and that when we are able to find ways to, you know, provide that type of transportation for all, you know.
Well, why not have all have individual, if everybody has a car?
I don't think everybody can have a car without polluting.
It's all electronic. It's all sun filtered. Everybody can do it. You don't have to have any limitation on it. Everybody's got transportation.
Well,
what's wrong with everybody having a good standard? You have to have some people be differentiating along the lines that some people, for some to have, others can't have. The zero sum. For one to win, everybody, some people have to lose. That kind of a, that's scarcity.
Yeah.
Thinking,
well, that's
and
the shift. That's the shift that's going on.
That are we? Do you think we're actually getting to a point where everybody can have an automobile? It's motivated by the sun. The beautiful sunlight's coming, and electricity is being generated, and it's making the environment richer in terms of all the resources, not polluting or anything. There's no loss.
That's right.
Just a gain for everything, for everybody, and everybody can have access to it. Is that something that is, as a metaphor, is something we might be striving for?
Well, yeah, but it's happening.
We do have vehicles
that run on electricity. And,
or on sunlight.
Yeah, but I think it goes deeper than that.
Okay,
there has to be a real deep understanding of the respect for each other, and it comes from just having proper living situations at home with enough to eat and a safe place to sleep. And the transportation.
Well, those are the beginnings.
Yeah.
Those are the beginnings. Yeah.
And
enough.
There's too many
people that
don't have that.
Everybody should have that. It's a sin that people, we have the capability to, there was a time when you couldn't do that. If you lived in the mountains of Europe at the time of Cro-Magnon, you could just barely find one. There were not enough caves to crawl in to get a little security from the tigers. There was no way you could even be thinking about that.
But right now,
we have a capability of making it possible for, it looks like we're heading for 10 billion people on this planet. And they could have non-polluting ways of getting everything available to them.
They may
all be able to live a life of material comfort, even abundance and that sort of thing. If not, why not? Why couldn't it be a life where everybody could maximize their total capability rather than so many people having to be stunted in what they're able to do because some others have to try and lord it over them or set up patterns of social organization that have people who are slaves, or you got to have people to pick up the trash, and these kind of rationalizations that make to hold us to the past rather than into the future that may be dawning if we just got our act together.
Exactly.
You do think?
Yeah, definitely. It takes dialogue and really thinking deeply on how to make this social change happen.
Yeah.
You know, right now we're dealing with what they call a school to prison pipeline.
Horrible. Yeah. Horrible. Horrible.
Really horrible.
It's racial. It's racism. Sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so we have to have the inner strength to take a look at that and really have reconciliation and change this. It's inhumane.
And that's
that
operates on a planetary scale too. I mean, you're talking about the nation.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. Well, our nation has the most imprisoned right now, and that needs to turn around. I mean, there needs to be an awareness and stop this, you know, creating, you know, the prison complex. I mean, it's privatization of a system, and all of that is something that needs to be understood.
It's like brutal.
You have to, yeah.
It's like brutal. It's like something that would be out of a dystopic movie 100 years from now. It'd be like a dystopic movie. How could they possibly have lived with such barbarous conditions being forced upon people and that kind of thing when it wasn't necessary?
Exactly.
Or does it always have to be the poor will always be with us? You have to have the poor to kick around?
No.
So the rich can feel strong and powerful?
Well,
that, or then that gets into a thing. A lot of men think that. You got to have women to kick around so that you got somebody that you can beat up on or something, some
right.
gross sort of macho baloney that is passes for macho maleism.
Exactly.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Well, it's about the consciousness of really having our humanity for all.
Is humanity enough? Do we have to go towards something beyond? We've been in this human thing 200,000 years. We've been 200,000 years on this planet with mm-hmm. some tenure and so forth.
Yeah.
Do we have to get to something beyond where we've been historically? Do we have to leave the womb of this 200,000 year sojourn in the womb of human history mm-hmm. and come into a new relationship, like
yeah.
coming, being birthed into a
yes.
new way of being that is emerging all
yeah.
around us and be able to recognize that,
uh-huh.
that we have an order that can allow for liberation of all
yes.
and generosity of the soul, generosity of caring for one another and everything where we
yes.
never have. It's always been me first, all that. Maybe that is something that's ahead.
This is the opportunity.
Yeah.
This is the opportunity.
Now the question comes down, which political party is going to get us there? Is it going to be the one from the right? Is it going to be from the left? Whose policy is right? Whose policy is wrong? Where are we going to draw understanding in a comprehensive way of how this something that never has been can be actually aborning, and we could be midwifing. That's a term for the women, right?
Yes,
midwifing this new order of transformative capability of the collective human society, well organized.
That's such a wonderful vision. I love that idea that, you know, you have come to recognize it is like a midwife. All these women that came back, they represent the midwife to this new birth, you know, of a new humanity that really does understand from a deep, compassionate way of empathizing with each other.
We brought up the
to
term.
Provide.
Yeah, we brought up the term the other in a way the heck back about the control freak.
Mm-hmm.
There's some people who just can't do anything but just get into every little thing and control people. They really want to control people.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some people who just are really much able to live and let live and recognize diversity.
Yes.
Things are different. Yeah. It's not all in one lockstep.
Uh-huh, yeah.
I was in the Borinqueneers. I was in the United States Army. I was drafted. This is a Puerto Rican Borinqueneer badge. I'm a Borinqueneer.
Mm-hmm.
From the United States Army.
Well, I mean, really,
I was drafted. I didn't want to go.
The Army and all the military really should be protectors, not destroyers.
Well, okay,
I mean,
they should be.
When you were in the Army, were you destroying or were you actually protecting?
I was trying
lives?
To avoid duty if I could because I thought it was just crazy, the whole thing. But they had a thing called the draft. You had to be drafted. You had to go if you're. See, ladies don't have to get drafted.
Yeah.
They don't draft ladies.
They haven't.
That's
done
an advantage you all have, right? I don't want to go fight, you know. And I, my sensitive soul won't allow me to stick a bayonet.
Well,
in
there
somebody.
Are women in the armed forces, but the thing is,
there's women wanting to get into the armed forces and stick bayonets
in right
on other
now,
people. That's strange.
Yeah. Well, I sense that it's
control freak.
Well, they want to protect, and because of the amount of fear that's been brought forth.
Ginned up, maybe. Ginned, you know, ginned up.
No.
Just PR'd up.
Yeah,
the
fear. Exactly.
It's a big industry.
Yeah,
built
huge.
On fear, don't you think?
Yeah, huge.
Yeah.
Huge.
And people will cower before fear if they're fearful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so then they'll do things that aren't natural to who they are. So I really think this is a time of transforming that into protection. I mean, what our Native Americans are doing, they're saying they're protecting the water.
Well, yeah, after we've destroyed every one of what happened in the Caribbean after Columbus was an absolute slaughter. It made, Treblinka look like a picnic.
Yeah.
It was horrible. They just destroyed everything, and that's been the march of a Western civilization across stealing the land. Stealing is the sport of the kings, you know, steal from the poor.
Yes.
And give to the rich. And that's the pattern of human development.
And that's what's out there now. And we're questioning
it. It's still
it.
In place.
Yeah. It is still in place. But the as the people are rising, they
you think,
are,
yeah.
Yeah. They're working in solidarity now to change that paradigm.
Uh-huh.
And it must, because the paradigm itself is not humane and it does not sustain life.
Yeah.
You know, so even these kings and queens and the hierarchy, they're very fearful. And through that, they've got to let go and allow what's happening to exist.
Okay. It's interesting.
It's
anyway, right.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
and
everything's shifting.
They're going to be heading toward that. It's a wonderful thought that we could be getting to that. The army, they didn't. They wanted you to be lockstep. You know, you they didn't want to hear what you were thinking, or what your ideas were, or anything. What they wanted you to do is do what you're told.
Right. Well, that's more of the...
That's like a control freak.
Yeah, yeah. That's more
they're
of
very control-oriented.
Yeah.
I used to try and explain... I was a private, and I was not a very good soldier. I kept trying to explain to the sergeants that we could do things democratically. Let's have a democratic meeting. And how come we privates are standing out here in the cold and y'all are in there where there's a nice stove going and everything? I used to try and explain these differentiations between, and they have a thing, rank has its privileges. There's a thing, rank has its privileges, young man, and everything like that. I didn't get along very well, but they made you go. You had to go then back if you were a man. You got out of that if you were a lady. You didn't have to go.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't that make you feel guilty?
Yeah. Well, no.
You didn't ever have to face going into the army and going off and kill people.
I thought about what I would do, and I would not. I'd be a conscientious objector.
You would, yeah.
Yeah. And so, but the thing is that it's a shifting scenario right now.
Mm.
And when we can be present and really be here, with what's needed.
Be here now.
Yeah, the be
here now. Who is
that?
Is that, is that not, is that, that's, is that Timothy Leary? Or one of the great sages
that
the
book? Timothy Leary and Ram Dass.
Ram Dass, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Alpert, that was his name, Alpert. He was a shrink, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of good people back then in those days. Yeah,
really. Yeah. Understanding the workings of our mind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, be present. And it's really coming from an Eastern philosophy.
We've had many good thinkers, haven't we? You know, we had...
And we still do.
Yeah, we do. Who are the people on the horizon that seem to be carrying it in a comprehensive way? Like, well, I don't know. I'm
so
awfully
many.
Given to Fuller and... You know, and some of those people like that, McLuhan, James Joyce, you know, and some of the poets and that.
Yeah.
But I don't know who.
Well, they
who's got it together
forth.
Comprehensive? And is it possible to get it together without being adversarial to the people who are talking about something other than what you're very vested in, if you understand what I mean?
Yes, yeah.
It is.
Well, that's
is that the mark?
Consciousness, yeah. There's a conscious activism that's come forth.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And that's really, you know, being there for the other and being aware.
And who's going to stand up for the least among us? Isn't somebody, there's people sleeping in the streets and the people that are going hungry and the people that are dying from starvation around the world and the lack of resources that could be got to them. And the United States of America now, they have nearly 65% of the budget of the United States of America. You know, you got a little bit for Social Security, a little bit for ladies needing this or the something or the animals or all the things that matter. 65, it's military. Military, 65%. Trident submarines, they're going to refurbish the Trident submarines to make the military power stronger so that they can be in the order. And that's what is called the leadership.
Yeah, well, that's just why there that are rising up and speaking out.
Are there people effectively doing it within the political? Is it possible to be worked out within the current political system that exists?
Yeah.
You think it can be worked out?
Definitely.
You do?
Yeah.
It's not on an order that calls for another level of thought other than the historically inherited institutions that are all around us, as well as all the literature that supports all the institutions that are all around us, that right. we give heedance to, credence to and everything. But you're talking about something new. Something new, not the reification or the reestablishment of these systems that have held in the past when there wasn't enough, let's just say. But now you're getting to a point where we can have things that we weren't able to have historically because they had to be invented and made both physical features and also thought patterns and things like that that weren't possible in the past given the condition of our relationship to the resource base and our historically inherited institutions. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's like a birth. You like the term.
Yeah, I do.
The term midwife, and you like the term. You come to the end of 9 months. It's a whole new world you're coming into.
That's right.
And humanity may be coming into that collectively.
This is a great analysis. Yeah,
that you do.
We are actually moving into a new birth. Birthing humanity where there's equality and justice
for all.
Yeah. And
it's in our literature.
Exactly.
Mr. Jefferson had a couple good words to say in that and everything.
That's right.
And there was a change being made, but it couldn't have been done then.
Yeah.
Couldn't have been done in that time. You had rutted roads, you had you had a whole bunch of Indian tribes to be killed off. And violence.
Yeah.
Male violence and fighting. It all had to be. We had to do all of that. We have to come to the very verge of killing off everybody. We have weapon systems that can wipe out the Homo sapien species now. We've reached that limit.
That's right.
Not just the tribe in the other valley.
And so this is an excellent time to take the opportunity to turn this all around because we have taken it to its very edge. And people are really frightened, and the leaders are very frightened. So they continue this threatening. It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we would have found a way to sustain ourselves and create this type.
So where are the transformative, qualitatively different voices being heard? I mean, where are the voices emerging? It's still just reifying
the
outdated. The left is talking about the left. The right is talking about the right and the institutions and, communism and capitalism and boo, 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 all the same old traditional thinking. But where are the new voices emerging that are ones that, like Galileo said, we're not the center of the universe?
Mm-hmm.
Messed people's identity up. Seriously.
Yeah.
They put them in jail.
Yes.
For saying something where they had their identity wrapped up in some sort of an order, like the old order.
Right.
Everybody's got their identity wrapped up in, there's not nearly enough, let's kill, 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 and everything.
Yeah.
And, but where are the new voices coming out
that
you can see?
These are the women and the men that are moving forward, the marches right now, and it's all on social media. It's a whole collection.
Yeah.
It's like, coming back to our families, to our communities, really speaking to each other and working together in cooperation.
Uh-huh.
That's moving. That's actually the birth of
a new way.
New humanity.
Yeah,
it's a global. Yeah. It has to be.
And
the media isn't covering it per se.
We got it on public access a little bit. Yeah.
Well, independent media has the opportunity.
Yeah.
And that's where we'll hear it. And just being outside talking to our neighbors and our community, the town hall meetings are coming forth.
Let there be town hall meetings and let there be and let there be programs on this theme. And we thank you.
Yeah.
We run out of time for the program.
Okay.
And we thank you in the audience for viewing. We're talking about a lot all over the lot, but talking about some of the issues that really are important in terms of the community. Thank you, Pamela.
Yeah,
my darling.
You.
Thank you very, very much.
You.
And thank you for viewing.
Harold,
we'll be coming back again tomorrow. That's it for now. And see if we can't run down some of those ideas and where they're. I think Thomas Piketty's good, worth listening to, in terms of the economics of